Here's the aftermath of the 95 Grand Marquis. This thing held up great for Susan. She had a lot of fun running it. A bit of a challenge, learning to drive a full size. First time ever for her, compared to running the front wheel drive cars. Front wheel drive cars do immensely better in a very muddy environment, and you can tell the difference when you're out there. So let's show you guys some of the damage to this car and go over it from front to back. And of course, show off the hardware that this thing won. She ended up finishing with a second place on this car. Finally, Susan gets herself a top three finish. She's been close several times with front wheel drive cars, coming in at fifth before with her Cutlass in the past. And it was kind of a strange ending. If you've seen the video, if you haven't seen it, make sure you guys go check it out, of the Owen County Spring Derby 2019. So all top three, first, second, third cars all ended up getting hung up on each other at the very end, because one of them had overheated and Susan ended up getting stuck inside of the fender well of it, and then couldn't get off of that. And then the other guy who was hitting her, trying to break her free, had no steering and ended up getting caught on the back of her. So it's kind of a crappy way to go. It is what it is, but car lives to see another day because of that reason. I mean, all three final cars can probably be ran again that were at that show, just because they didn't have a chance to really duke it out and fight each other at the end. Usually that's when your car receives a lot of damages, that final three moment when you're fighting back and forth with some good shots on each other. So you will notice on this car, she kept it pretty clean with the steering and the tires. That's definitely what we wanted on this thing, especially with our original aluminum rims. We wanted to protect that really well. This was basically a bone stock show. Stock class, bone stock would be a better definition. The only thing you're really allowed to do out there is put on some tire flaps, switch out your bumpers, and that's really about it. You have to keep the original engine make to make. Ford engine must be in a Ford car, Chevy engines and Chevy cars, and so forth. Cannot even have no rollover bars. You can't crease the car. All kinds of stuff has to stay original. We even, like I said, we only have a seat bar in this car, and we left the passenger seat in it. Very basic setup out there, and a lot of the other cars were just as stock. So that's why I wasn't as worried for a lot of things on this car, because everyone else is going to be in the same boat as us. So let's look at this front bumper. You guys will notice it is twisted. If you look at it on this side only, and that side actually would have done the same thing, but I'll show you why it didn't. So this corner here, a pretty good shot came on it from another 90s Lincoln Town Car, I believe, came in underneath this, and it came in, popped it up in the air, and it came underneath this car, which forced that bumper to bend upwards when it came underneath. And also at the same time when it went underneath there, it got a hold of that core support and it shoved the entire bottom of that core support under. You can tell it's tipped at a pretty good angle. Luckily the radiator has survived, it just cocked it underneath, and we almost lost the radiator hose. It's getting ready to get pinched, but still managing to hold together. So where this bent at, the actual bumper shock is still 100% straight in the frame. Instead, it bent this front mount that welds on to the front frame right here. So you can see this has picked up. It has tilted the bumper shock. There's your bolt to the bumper shock. It's pivoted it upwards, and it bent the front frame with it, but the actual box frame is still the same. And the other side would have done the same, but, oh, a crazy thing here. Keep in mind, these bumper shocks were drilled and collapsed. They just stuck out that much further. Like that one over there is a collapsed bumper shock. It just sticks out that much further in the front. So this one over here, there is where it was used to be bolted. There's where it's now bolted. Did not break the bolt. Instead, it actually ripped the piece of frame off that is where that circle hole is factory drilled, and there's usually metal on the frame right there on both sides of this frame. It sheared that off, and it rammed the entire bumper shock all the way deep into the frame, as far back as it'll go, until this bolt is now hitting this extra piece of plate right here on the frame. And that thing is buried now, so this front bumper is fully collapsed into that front end. It's tight in there, and it's definitely not going to come back out with the way it's shoved in. So it's going to remain that way. But that is the reason this side did not tip up with this front factory plate on the frame. It's buried itself way back in there. But the bumper itself is still perfectly fine. The bumper is not twisted. It's just that front mount where the bumper and the bumper support go through. But that can be fixed, no big deal there. We can pull this back straight. We'll fix the bumper shocks. It'll be good to go for another run on that case. Let's go ahead and pop the hood on this thing. So you can see here the fenders, she did a really good job keeping the fenders clean. People were hitting the sides of the car, the back of the car, and the bumper, but nothing really on the front corners, which is what we needed to protect on these cars, especially with the factory suspension. So pulling the hood up here, you'll notice all of our original wiring is still perfectly fine. Nothing has come loose on this car. Everything is still strapped down nice and solid. All of our zip ties held up. I was worried about that. Engine runs phenomenal still. It did not stall once out there. This car didn't even overheat really in the Derby. The radiator's still holding water. We had the fan on the whole time. All that is perfectly fine. Suspension is good. Steering is good. No worries at all there. And remember, we did mention this core support. See down there where it is kicked out down low? Let's come over here. And because it has kicked that bottom out, it is now pinching this radiator hose in between the radiator and the very tip of your steering box right there. So that'll need to get this core support pulled back down. We'll move that hose out of the way next time so it doesn't get pinched in there. And we should be okay. The frame itself has not even moved, has not even tried to nose up at all on this thing. And we thought it was during the Derby just because of that bumper tipping up, but nah, no frame damage at all. So working our way around the car, take you around to the back side of it. No driver's door hits this time. That's surprising. Usually you get at least one of those in every Derby nowadays. So back tires are still great. Nobody even touched the rims on them. It was all corner damage on this thing. You will see our back has rolled fantastic on this car. It's almost even. This side is just slightly higher than that side. You look at it, just barely higher. I mean like an inch higher, but it's rolling pretty even. That's what we want on this car. So that has gone up, and it went up exactly where we notched it. There is our original notches. I put them right here by the factory hole and close to where some of the rear body mounts are so that it would all hold together. And it's tipped right in there. It's collapsed together. So that's doing good on this side. The exact same on the other side has happened. We do have another set of relief cuts further under here, closer to that second body mount that's back there. Those have not started to collapse yet. So those will be the next to go once this bumper rolls up and into the trunk. Trunk lid still perfectly fine, has not moved. I really thought somebody would clear this back bumper and hit the trunk lid early, but it didn't. It was mostly bumper to bumper hits, so that did help it roll. The trunk lid has pinched in place. It's no longer gonna worry about popping up. We can get that packed in there tight, redo some nine wire a bit. It'll be okay. Coming over here on the passenger side frame rail, you can see it is bent up perfectly with our notch. Right there's our notch halfway down. The frame's sliding inside of the other frame, exactly what I wanted it to do when I bent the notches. So it'll pack in nice and solid on this car. And the humps are still great on this car. No worries there. No issues with this thing starting to move in weird places. Now here's something we do need to address for the next time this car runs, and that is right here. So we put these tires on the car, and these are pretty much street, basic street tires. No mud traction whatsoever on these things. I'll show you this side, it's easier to see. Right there, you can see there is no actual type of mud traction. It's just straight line grooves on all of this tire. And we had called the promoter in advance and talked to them and said, hey, you know, it has to be in your rules, you say DOT street tires. We said, can we go aggressive tires? I told them I have some street tires that have okay tread on them. Can I regroove my street tires to a mud pattern? And we were told, no, you cannot regroove any tires at all. And they told me that everybody else is going to be showing up with really basic street tires on these cars. So I really did not stress about it. I threw on some basic street tires to this car. I assumed they would condition the arena correctly to match street tires. They wouldn't make it too soupy or too wet. You know, everybody would have somewhat of a chance to get some traction out there. Well, we were greatly mistaken. And this is something, guys, that I always tell everybody, if you've never been to a Derby before at a certain place, always go there maybe the year before, a different Derby before, go in the pits, see how the rules are, see how inspections are, get a feel for the arena, see what passes or what doesn't pass. Because you need to know what you can and can't do to your car. And this is a perfect example. Most of the other cars that showed up did have DOT tires, but they were all like DOT mud tires, DOT winter tires. They were not street tread tires. And that's what threw me for a loop in their rules and my communications with them a little bit off. I don't know, I'm not blaming them for it. It was just something you gotta learn to deal with. So when Susan went out there in this car, you're going to see it in the video, it had probably the worst traction out of most of the cars that were out there. There's a couple others that had really basic street tires as well, a handful of us, and you'll see them all just spinning and spinning and spinning, and finally it would dig through the mud and catch some hard ground underneath it, and then it would take off. And once the car was moving, it was fine. But that initial moment, if there was a red flag and they said go, you were a sitting duck for a good 20 seconds until the car actually caught some traction and took off. And that was what hindered this car the most. There was a couple really good shots that Susan made with this car, but they didn't have enough momentum following into the impact to do the damage we wanted to the opponent's cars. They were in the right location. She had really good placement with her hits. And we're gonna solve that next time around. We're gonna go ahead, she took second place, we're gonna take that prize money, and we are going to buy some really nice, brand new DOT tires that actually have traction on them, and we will throw them on some steel rims for this car. Because we do not have any steel rims for this full-size stuff. I got rid of all my full-size stuff long ago. So this car was a very beginner basic build using whatever we had on the car already. That's why you see what we have. So yeah, we can spend that prize money and at least upgrade this car. And hopefully those tires will have flaps on them and they will survive more than one car. We can use them for future cars. If we ever find another full-size again with a Ford Bolt pattern, we'll have that. So there you go, that'll explain some stuff. I know people are gonna be complaining in the video or questioning it. That should clear things up on you guys on what was going on there. Other than that, there's nothing serious we need to do to fix this car for the next run. We're just gonna do some front end corner repair, and I'm gonna help this pack in a little bit better. I may open up my notches a little more and check some more frame underneath the car, but we're good. Interior's still fine, nothing has come loose, no leaks, no fuel lines, no crazy electrical problems. This car is ready for another run. So, be sure to check out the GoPro footage, check out the grandstands footage. I did film all of the classes for that night. I did not do a prelude because I did not have enough time. We were busy getting this car completely nine-wired after inspections and talking to a whole bunch of my fans, which thanks everybody that came out. A lot of my fans came out to say hi. Many of you I have not had a chance to meet before because we've not come down to that southern part, south of Indianapolis and Indiana area, and got to meet a lot of you guys. It was really fun to see that. So, no prelude, but don't worry guys, there will be plenty of other shows we're going to film this year. General rule of thumb, if it's a show that either myself or Susan is going to be driving in, usually we don't have time to do a prelude or film all of the classes. We try to do what we can with our free time available, but if we're running a car, then that uses up most of our free time getting that car on and off the track, on the trailer, and everything else during the other events. So, this car's going back in the garage. We'll get it under repairs. And it's time to jump on the next car. Everybody saddle up. She's back for another run real soon here. So look for a video on that.